Good morning, everyone. My name is Carla Morales. I'm the Vice President of the Arizona Technology Council, and it is my absolute pleasure to welcome you all to the Arizona Technology Council November Virtual Tech Talk Speaker Series event. Today, the focus is on the future of hypersonics. I'd like to remind you all that the council puts on over 100 events throughout the year in Phoenix and Tucson. Please make sure that you visit aztechcouncil.org to find out more of the upcoming events and information on membership and sponsorship if you're not already a member. We have so many events coming up for 2023, but we have just a few that we want to remind you for the remainder of the year, and we hope that you can join us in person. Tomorrow, we will be at Leonardo Electronics for our November After 5 Mixer. If you're able to join us, please make sure to visit our website to register for that. And in December, we have our Cybersecurity Breakfast Forum in Scottsdale, Arizona. And then back here in Tucson on December 14th, we will have our Tucson After 5 Holiday Mixer at the Tucson Historical Museum and featuring the history of technology. Some amazing programs coming up. So I encourage you all to, again, visit the website and get more information about that. Just a few housekeeping notes before we get started. Please make sure that you turn off your cameras and mute your microphones. And we encourage you to ask questions, and we do so by asking you to put those on the chat option. And then our moderator will make sure to address those during the QA session of the program. You may also raise your hand emoji during the QA session and unmute yourself to ask your question. Thank you all so much. And at this point, I'd like to yield the floor over to Alex Rodriguez, President and CEO of Freefall 5G, who will be doing the honors of moderating today's talk. Alex, the floor is yours.
Carla, thank you so much. Good morning, everybody, and welcome to this very, very important and exciting virtual tech series on the future of hypersonics. Thank you to each of you for joining us and for your interest in this important subject of hypersonics. And of course, a special, very special thank you to the Arizona Technology Council, to Carla and Jamie and the whole team for bringing us together this hour to go deep on this particular subject area. Hi, everybody. My name is Alex Rodriguez. I'll be your moderator for today. As Carla mentioned, I am the CEO of Freefall 5G, a disruptive antenna company for fifth generation wireless communication standards, and more importantly, a keen observer of strategic and tactical global defense developments. The hypersonic cruise missile and the fast evolving field of hypersonics is critical to U.S. national security and to the broader international security landscape. Hypersonics is also a potential, has the potential to disrupt cargo and passenger and space travel, plus much more that we will learn about over the next hour. So today, you will hear from subject matter experts in this field who are helping lead the future of hypersonics on a national scale, really global scale, from here in our own backyard. Everything we discuss, just an FYI, will be open source only in case some of you expect to learn things behind the wall. That's not for this session. Attendees will have a chance to ask questions. Again, as Carla mentioned, just don't feel bad if you ask a question that sort of veers into a classified nature. I'm sure that will not be addressed. So I anticipate a rich discussion among our panel experts, and I want to congratulate each one of you panelists for your accomplished body of work to date in the field of hypersonics. Everybody, let's welcome our distinguished panel now. You can join me by sharing a high five or some kind of emoji saying welcome or hypersonics in the chat room. Say hi to our panelists. First, begin with Erica Corral, PhD, who is an associate professor of material science and engineering. She's an associate professor of aerospace and mechanical engineering and associate professor at the University of Arizona Bio-5 Institute. She's a distinguished scholar in material science and engineering. So let's welcome Erica. Erica, And next, I will have each of them introduce themselves in just a second. Next is Alex Craig, Assistant Professor for Aerospace and Mechanical Engineering, also at the University of Arizona. Alex, thank you so much for joining us this morning. Third is Professor Jesse Little, Professor and Associate Head for Graduate Studies for the Department of Aerospace and Mechanical Engineering at the University of Arizona. Welcome, Professor Little. And out of industry today, we're thrilled to have Mr. John Otto, who is a Senior Director for Advanced Hypersonic Weapon Systems at Raytheon Missile and Defense. And so, Mr. Otto, welcome to the panel. Okay, so distinguished panel members, please tell us about your professional background relative to hypersonics, starting with Dr. Corral, then Dr. Craig, followed by Dr. Little and Mr. Otto. Erica.
Hi, thank you, and welcome everyone to our discussion today. My background is on high temperature materials, so most of the materials that experience a very heavy heat load from external flow fields or internal combustion parts are the focus of the research that I've been pursuing for the past 15, almost 20 years. And the application will enable the hypersonic flight vehicle to sustain long duration operation under heavy heat load time periods. So they're critical in the sense that they'll help maintain the shape of the vehicle while allowing to function in the extreme flight environment. So I invite all of you to visit us at the University of Arizona and get a glimpse of what we do in person. That's one of my main interest is sharing what we do, not with just our undergraduate students, but our community, and engage them in understanding how critical this technology is for not only commercial applications, but for national security. Thank you.
Excellent. Excellent, Erica. Thank you so much. Dr. Craig, welcome, sir.
Hello, I'm Alex Craig. My background is high-speed aerodynamics, experimental aerodynamics. So I'm a wind tunnel guy at heart. I have been working in this field for 13 years, I guess now, with a brief time away at the national labs doing something else for a couple of years. But that's my background. I'm primarily interested in a handful of related aerodynamics topics that are trying to answer the question, where is something going to get hot? How fast is it going to get hot, and how hot is it going to get? Would be sort of the three fast questions that I'm trying to answer with my research. And of course, as a professor at a university that's deeply engaged in this topic, we're certainly working on the workforce development aspect as well, trying to make sure that we're bringing students up in this ecosystem and giving them the skills they need to hit the ground running once they get out into industry.
Outstanding, sir. Thank you so much. We appreciate that. And Dr. Little.
Hi, my name is Jesse Little. I'm a professor of aerospace and mechanical engineering. I've been at the U of A for going on 13 years now. I came in 2010. And I originally did a lot of work in low-speed aerodynamics, also experimental. I do a lot of wind tunnel testing, so I'm also the second half of the wind tunnel team here at U of A. In the last 8 or so years, I've done a lot more high-speed wind tunnel work, specifically related to hypersonics, but still keep some activities in the lower-speed world as well. So I'll have all sorts of speed ranges that are examined in my group. And one of the things that we've been putting a lot of emphasis in our department, especially Alex and I, is building up our wind tunnel capabilities to serve both our internal research efforts and also external customers like Raytheon Missiles and Defense, government labs, and all manner of customers from around the U.S. So we're very excited to be on the scene with some very unique capabilities. And one of the other things that we're always doing, as Alex mentioned, is trying to bring our students into this world so they're prepared for careers in industry.
Outstanding. Thank you so much. Appreciate that, Jesse. Before I go to Mr. John Otto from Raytheon, just a quick disclaimer. I spent nearly a decade working for the company in the early 2000s. This technology back then was sort of in research infancy, if I recall correctly, John. Take it away, sir.
Yeah, you know, so I'm John Otto. I'm the Director for Advanced Hypersonic Weapons at Raytheon Missiles and Defense. So, you know, what I do is deal with our air breathing and boost glide technologies, both on the offensive and defensive side. I've been with the company for 25 years. I've got degrees in mechanical and aero engineering, as well as, at some point deciding to go down the program management path. But, I think if you go all the way back, I actually did chemical laser work when I was in grad school. And that gets into the supersonic combustion and the types of things that you deal with in hypersonic systems. But I've really been involved in hypersonics going back about 9 years ago when I was the program manager for the Hawk program. And, that was something new. You mentioned that, Alex, that, hypersonics, the concept of hypersonics has been around for a while. I mean, it's no secret that the designs have been around. I think it's just been, getting to the point where we place an emphasis on it and have, the ability to really model it and stuff like that. And I think that's where we've really focused. And that's what I wound up dealing a lot with as we moved through the Hawk program and, eventually gotten to where we are today, where we're trying to manage a portfolio of programs to, serve the nation and protect our national security.
Very well, John, and to all you panelists, thank you so much for your introductory comments and sharing a little bit about your professional background. And so to sort of help level set for all our audience members today, I think it'd be good if you could please tell us, answer the fundamental question here. What is hypersonics baseline for all of us to be on the same sheet of music, if you will? How far along is the actual evolution that John just alluded to in terms of deployment, evolution, ideation, design, development? And where is the technology in terms of actual deployment in the field today? If we can go around, starting with, we'll start with you again, Mr. Otto.
Yeah, so I work in our advanced technology mission area here. And so, we try to get involved in things that are more early development type efforts, things that we're trying to grow into products. And so we're not, that's different than what you would see in one of our other mission areas where we're focused primarily on production. But, there's been programs out there like X-51, which, was started in the early 2000s and continued out into the early 20-teens. And there's been other programs, and that was more of a missile program. There's also been a lot of more platform-type programs where they've tried to come up with the National Aerospace Plan and other sorts of things out there that got into high-speed flow. When we talk hypersonics, what we're really trying to say is things that go faster than Mach 5. And Mach is the speed of sound. So it's basically five times the speed of sound. If you want to try to put a number to it, it's like flying a mile a second, give or take in terms of the speed. So you could go, LA to New York in 40 minutes if you flew hypersonically. And so at those speeds and regimes, Dr. Craig hit it pretty well. You get into a lot of thermal issues, things heat up at different rates. And that creates a bunch of challenges. I think where we've really tried to focus our effort on is, the digital engineering side of things, the modeling and sim. And I think that's one of the big things that really helped us, understand how these systems work, where you really get to the basic understanding of the physics that's going on. And then that helps you from a design perspective, because, once you see the physics, you understand how the bodies react, then you can start designing around things. And I think that's been one of the big improvements that's been happening over the last decade or so to really make these vehicles something that's much more attainable.
Thank you. And Professor Little, evolution of hypersonics, deployment, developments.
I think I focus that question more on how we're doing things at the university level compared to the past. So In the past, we were very much focused on basic science, fundamental research. In the wind tunnel world, that would mean everything's pretty small, small-scale wind tunnels, really small problems associated with hypersonics. With the national interest in this area, we're seeing universities, in some respects led by Arizona, get into the applied space using facilities that allow us to do work that's related to real-world problems. And in the past, you know, 10 years ago, this wasn't happening. So the national, you know, push for hypersonics has trickled down to the university level, both for testing, for research, actually being involved in the applied programs that are ongoing in the U.S., but even more so on the workforce development side. So we are really being charged with producing a workforce that's ready to go when they come out of our universities. This is much more than in the past.
Since you mentioned that the wind tunnel and the recent facilities, I guess improvements with the University of Arizona in particular, I know Governor Ducey and Dr. Robbins had a big to-do not too long ago where they highlighted the new wind tunnel capability. Can you talk a little bit more about what is the state of the wind tunnel and what does that mean in terms of for any industry players? How can they connect with you and Craig and Erica for leveraging interest in this area?
Sure, I can say a little bit, and then I would probably kick to Alex to speak more from his side of the house. So we here at the university are operating two, I would say, large-scale wind tunnels in the university sense. There are two tunnels that are roughly 15 inches in diameter or 15 by 15 in cross-section. And both of these facilities are relatively unique on the national level. Those investments by the state and also by the federal government have allowed us, and the university, have allowed us to stand up these tunnels. And we're able to do work in these facilities that previously would have been the work you would do at government laboratories or even industry tunnels. So we're really able to get into that space because of the investments we've received from the state, the University of Arizona, and the DOD. So what that means is that we can have programs come into us. We can do testing on preliminary concepts. We have a number of programs already that we work with our friends in town and then others across the country. Basically, we will provide wind tunnel services, wind tunnel testing to customers for various types of problems, weeks at a time. Just depends on the nature of the problem. We'll be ramping that up more and more as we go along in the next few months.
Okay. Alex?
Yeah. I think what I would point out is that historically, to add on to what Jesse said, historically, universities, our bread and butter is what would be called basic or fundamental research, where you're doing, you get grad students in a lab, you have them, you know, shining their microscope on some really small piece of a much larger puzzle, investigating the fundamental physics of, in our case, how a fluid flows over an object in a wind tunnel. We still do a lot of that, but one of the things that these new tunnels that we've been able to complete here has enabled is for us to really move strongly into the more applied research and testing world that Jesse was talking about. And from an educational standpoint, we certainly still want to keep one foot firmly planted in this basic research world. But at the same time, we're trying to, keep the other foot firmly planted in the applied research and testing services type world. And I think that this is, a good move for a couple reasons, one of which is that there's a huge national need for wind tunnel time. The large national facilities have, queues running in the months or even years to get in and do testing. So if we can provide an opportunity for companies to come in and do some of their earlier on testing in a facility that can act in a more nimble way than some of these national facilities, that's a really good opportunity for us, and it's a really good opportunity for the companies. And at the same time, I think it's nice because it gets the students, it gives them a chance to sort of get their feet wet on problems that are more industry facing in addition to what they're used to doing and maybe the more basic problems that they're earning their degrees studying.
Thank you for that. And Erica, I think we can take a quick pause here too to ask you, Erica, to share maybe some of your slides that you had prepared for us this morning. Do you have sharing capability or?
I will find out.
Let's see if.
Erica, you should have sharing capabilities.
All right, great. Yeah. So do you see these slides?
We do. Perfect.
Okay. So it's kind of a good segue to talk about how University of Arizona and Raytheon and have been, you know, pushing the needle on becoming and or, you know, providing national leadership in hypersonics. So the topics I'll cover are just how we're doing that as a university with industry and talk briefly about the integration facility that that will be standing up in addition to the wind tunnels. So, and if you're following this beat, you'll notice that the drumming has gotten louder around the national security threat where the US is behind our adversaries in hypersonic weapon systems. And in 2020, the Secretary of Defense for Research and Engineering created the Joint Hypersonics Transition Office. And one of their first tasks was to create the university consortium for applied hypersonics to pull together all the stakeholders they need to help overcome this challenge from industry, academia, and the government. So U of A is part of the national leadership team. Raytheon is on our industrial advisory board executive committee. And we've been providing leadership in forming this consortium since inception. And what's critical about this note is that this is, I've never seen this before. I was at a national lab prior to working on hypersonics. And this is the first time I've seen such a huge investment from our government into academia to help enable some of these applied hypersonic science and technology solutions to future weapon systems and design space that will be critical in training our workforce. So it's over a $100 million investment to start the consortium, and it has grown significantly since then. And it is permanently in the president's budget so that this consortium can continue to enable some of the leap ahead technologies that we need for these complex systems. So the research projects that they fund are technology readiness level between 6.2 and 6.4. Most of them, or not if all of them, have technology transition partners from industry. Raytheon is a partner on a lot of these projects, not just with U of A, but we have a significant synergy across materials, guidance, navigation, and controls, and applied aero. The consortium is closed only to U.S. citizens. So this is also, you know, to help build a network of stakeholders that can share information at the appropriate levels. Currently, the membership has over 104 university members institution-wise and 141 industry affiliate members. So we have more industry members than university members. The number of students is continuously growing. It's over 370. FFRDCs and UARCs are kind of like federal national laboratory type of entities. And membership is represented from over 40 states in the US. So it is really it's really made a significant impact in broadening the ecosystem that we are developing to help enable workforce development and applied S&T to, you know, accelerate technology. So these are some of the leadership positions that I'm involved in as part of the governance board. And one of the main tasks I have is to bring this national network of industry affiliates in a technology transition committee to help identify ways where we can leverage the S&T investments from the UCA and or vice versa to enable more progress in this technical area. So it's been a very exciting project, and we're involved in helping support government activities such as their roadmaps, technical, long-term, near-term solutions. And as part of our effort here in Southern Arizona, we're working to create this like regional ecosystem as well to help support not only Raytheon, but also our defense contractor base in the region. So we are providing that national leadership as well. This last slide that I have just kind of shows my technical area of expertise and what the next generation of the investments represents from the university and federal government. It's going to be an integration facility where we can incorporate materials and expose them to high enthalpy flows and understand how they behave and, you know, to ping what John was saying, help develop some of these critical digital footprints that we need to do design of these systems. So I think that's all I have.
Hey, Carla, thank you, or Erica, forgive me. Thank you so much for that overview. And it's remarkable how much is actually happening at the national level and let alone here, our local efforts. Given that we have Carla Morales Bernal and also Steve Salstra on the call, perhaps it's time for a Arizona Technology Council Hypersonics Committee to help incubate, engagement throughout the state. But I bringing us back out to the 30,000 foot level, if you will, sort of help us with the macro, and then we'll dive deep into questions of design to more of a technical nature. Before we do that, I just want to mention last night I spent time reviewing the United States National Security Strategy that was released last month by this administration, as well as the U.S. National Defense Strategy. And what is clear is that the United States is, the president keeps calling this the decisive decade based on technological advances that will happen between now and 2030. And what is clear is that the Pentagon and everyone in Washington, D.C. is now focused on assuring that we not only shore up and not only catch up in certain areas, but dominate across the spectrum of technology where we can use it and leverage it for warfighter superiority and maintain U.S. advantage in national security. And to me, what I guess the question in my mind, you're involved on a day-to-day basis, panelists. Where are we in terms of just your perception of where we're at in terms of the competition and the threat by other countries? I believe there's three other nations so far that have fielded hypersonic missiles that have actually tested them. I'm just curious from your perspective, what is the current thinking? Are we behind in hypersonics and this is a hurry up offense, or are we engaged in a deliberate process actually making more advances than our adversaries, would-be adversaries? John Little.
John Otto.
John, or Jesse Little.
Thank you, Erica.
Yeah, so I think you're trying to put that one over towards me. You know, there's a lot of stuff in the news. You know, I think everybody kind of sees what's going on in the world today, and there's obviously a lot going on in China and Russia, and they're publishing, at least in the news, what we're doing. You're talking about exact capability and stuff like that. That's something that's difficult to comment on. You know, we are focused, pretty squarely on, certainly, here and what I do, we're focused on developing systems that can get out there into the field. And what we can point to is a couple of successful tests that we've had on the Hawk program over the last little over a year. So, you know, we've been able to push forward there and demonstrate that, you know, the technology is viable. And then, you know, we've also been selected by the Air Force to work with them to develop, you know, a hypersonic system. So, you know, it's something that we've put a lot of emphasis on. You know, we've gotten some successes under our belt, and, you know, I think we've been able to show that, you know, there's viability in the technology and that we're moving it forward.
Okay. And now this time, Professor Little.
Sure. I'm not going to give you a direct answer, but I will say that we are working very hard and feeling a lot of pressure to produce results and a quality workforce, even at the university level. I'll leave it at that.
Okay. Professor Craig, your observations?
I don't think it's out of line to say that I think we're probably behind right now. Doesn't have to stay that way. I guess one thing I would mention is that it's hard to say for certain whether you are ahead or behind, in part because the sort of way that all of these different countries are envisioning using these, the sort of systems they're all developing are, you know, it's not all one-to-one matches between what we're doing, what, you know, China's doing, what Russia's doing. Everyone, at least for now, sort of has their own ideas for how this is going to work within the context of their goals. And so, I think that it's a little bit also more difficult to pin down like exactly where everyone stands, because everyone's got slightly different ideas of what they're doing with this.
Erica, your observations on the current state?
We're behind and we're working hard to get ahead.
Understand. And audience members, Russia, China have, and of course the United States have tested hypersonic cruise missiles. And more recently, India has joined this group of select countries, if you will, around the world. So I don't know of other nations as of yet that have actually tested successfully hypersonic missiles. But President Putin called his program an invincible program, meaning there's no real countermeasure against a weapon system like the one that they tested, apparently, is what he said. Let me turn attention now to...
At one point, the Iron Spear, right, was considered invincible. Nothing stays invincible forever. And people, as long as people have developed offensive capabilities, people have worked to develop defensive capabilities to, counter those. So it's always a perpetual, you know, back and forth, right? I don't think that anything should be considered invincible, certainly not forever.
Thank you for stating that. We shouldn't leave it hanging. That's the story of humanity, is measures, countermeasures. And this is no different. However, where we're at today is a particular weak spot, if you will, from a national security perspective. What I'd like to do next is switch the subject over to let's go deeper into what your particular area of expertise is and what you're focused on a day-to-day basis. What are the main issues that you are tackling with in terms of design development, any prototyping happening, or issues around being able to demonstrate the work that you're carrying out today? And Alex, we'll start with you on that one.
Main issues. I mean, like I said before, from my perspective, you know, what my small slice of this ecosystem is, it's trying to figure out where things get hot, how fast they get hot, how hot they get. And I think that the process that we've gone through to build up our infrastructure, our wind tunnel infrastructure, has gotten us a long way towards being able to do a lot of what we'd like to do in that area. A lot of the problems that we have are sort of a smaller version of what John probably faces, workforce, right? I feel like we've gotten our facilities up to a point where they're getting where we need them to be, but at this point we need to make sure we've got a steady stream of good grad students that we can bring through our lab. So this is maybe not the answer you were originally seeking, but really for us at the university level, it's making sure that we've got a good supply of students and expertise that, or I guess not expertise because we're working to train that, right? But a good supply of students who are of high quality, motivated, and that we can backfill once they graduate, because that's one thing that we deal with at the university is, the goal is to get them out of here, right? We're not trying to retain them forever. We are trying to get them to the point where they can leave us and go off on their own. And so you need a steady supply to maintain that. And of course, just like anybody else, we're being pinched by supply chains as we try to run these wind tunnels and we've got to, do repairs, do constant maintenance, do consumables for the wind tunnels. Trying to get materials and supplies has continually become a bit of a nightmare for us. So that's, again, sort of a scaled back version of what the big guys like Raytheon are dealing with.
A great segue to John Otto.
Oh, you're on mute. Think you're still on mute.
John.
Okay, let's try it now. Third time's a charm. No, thanks for that, Alex. Alex brings up a really good point, in terms of, what we're doing as we continue to grow and evolve what we're doing, you've got to have a workforce to fill the need. And I think that's one of the reasons, why we've been working with Arizona and other universities, because we want to make sure that we do continue to grow that workforce. So as the demand for these systems continues to increase, that we're able to fill it. There's other things that are challenges. There's certainly a demand to do things faster. And I think that's one of the reasons why we're placing a great emphasis on digital engineering versus having to go out and test, because while testing is very good, it also takes time. And Alex highlighted some of the issues that you have there. But that's one of the reasons why we've really tried to focus on, developing prototypes versus demonstrators. And that's something that, there's a lot more traceability in what we're testing today and what we would ultimately field than maybe what there had been in the past. And I think that prototype development is something that really helps us get things out into the field quicker, which is, kind of the demand that we face right now. And, it also helps, and just to highlight, Alex was talking about the wind tunnel, and Jesse's talked about it too, the wind tunnel facilities that we have in Arizona. I think that's a great thing. More test facilities, is always going to be a better thing, because, there are things, tunnels get used, they have to go through maintenance, they're not always available and things like that. So having more capability in that area is really good, and having it really close to home is even better for us. So we really appreciate what the University of Arizona is doing there.
Okay, thank you so much, Erica.
I would say this is helpful to introduce the topic, the need, the critical resource that we have here in Southern Arizona, and how we can elevate this topic to help sustain that workforce. Because I would say that it's a matter of minutes before, students get, hired by industry, even before they graduate. I think there's a significant pressure on universities right now to stand up this workforce, and there's inherent challenges in doing that, because the type of research funding that we're using to train these students is applied in nature. So there's certain controls and aspects to how we do we do research that's now applied and controlled access. So the universities that really understand these challenges have stepped up to the plate and, you know, helped support infrastructure-wise, what resources we need to execute applied work, and also systems to help control information and provide students that relevant training in doing technical work in this controlled environment. So I think the dialogue and the more people that recognize this as a critical need to our region, I think we'll be able to further advance our mission and be successful in training the workforce and getting the applied science and technology that's needed to enable these, you know, leap ahead technologies, because we do need to out innovate our adversary. We do need to apply solutions that will come out of academia that, you know, we are being tasked to do. So right now we need investments in our universities and our regional ecosystem to help stand up the workforce that is not only going directly to our region, but is also being, you know, populated across the country like I've never seen before. So, I mean, I've been doing this for a long time now, and this has been very intense. So there's a critical need to get this message out within our region so that we can help support and grow this technical workforce and infrastructure.
Yes, absolutely. And Erica, thank you so much for, I tell you, university is doing a fantastic job at making the case here. The workforce is absolutely essential to the future of hypersonics, and we need to marshal that effort going forward. Professor Little.
Sure. Talking about my own research first, like everybody's mentioned, we all are primarily concerned with heating when it comes to hypersonics. And my particular part of this puzzle is I tend to look at flows or regions of flows where shock waves interact with flows over the surface of the vehicle. Those are unavoidable in hypersonics, and they're very challenging aerodynamics problems. They can have detrimental effects like loss of control authority, high pressure loading, unsteady pressure loading, high heat fluxes, and also contribute to instabilities or general types of problems in air breathing propulsion systems. So that's where I spend a lot of my time. More recently, we've been doing these kinds of things on more applied systems. So in the past, we studied these types of flow fields in what I'll call unit problems, or very simple, basic problems. But with our continued efforts into more applied areas, we're looking at these in a more, I wouldn't say a full system, but something that's much closer to a system than we as universities had done in the past. Picking up on something that Erica mentioned related to workforce, this is absolutely crucial for us, as you might have guessed, both here at the university and also nationwide. One of our challenges is attracting quality domestic students, U.S. citizens. Not everything we do requires citizenship, but a lot of it does, and those are going to be the most attractive graduates. Very often we are able to get those students security clearances while they're students at the university, specifically graduate students. That really sets them up for employment right away. And one thing I'll mention, whether it's, I don't know if I'll have a chance to speak again, but one thing I want to mention here is that we are truly leading in hypersonics here in Southern Arizona, with obviously Raytheon and also University of Arizona. We have top 10, top 5 schools coming up and asking people like Erica, Alex, and myself for advice on how they can replicate what we're doing. So I really want to point that out to this group, that you have a national leader in hypersonics here, and we have great things ahead of us.
Excellent. Now, if we step back a second, investments at the Pentagon and in national security writ large have had substantial commercial derivatives, right? From whether it was the ARPANET to the internet, or even arguably more recently, fifth generation wireless standards, just across the board. I'm curious, in terms of your take and what you see over the next decade, fundamentally, we're working on the hypersonic cruise missile and beating the bad guys, or at least having the advantage there. But what do you see in terms of the applicability of hypersonics in other areas? Obviously, with the heat that's required for hypersonic vehicle of some sort to move from point A to point B. Alex keeps talking about how critical, you know, we must get through certain technical milestones, right, before we can actually have applicable opportunity for hypersonics in other fields. What do you see evolving outside of the hypersonic cruise missile? Somebody jump in and go first. Erica?
I was going to say, there's certainly one thing that I feel like has really popped up lately is that the Department of Defense has started more intentionally leveraging like private capital. So you see startups that are starting to form in this space or have been over the past, you know, five-ish, maybe back to 10 years, but certainly in the last five, there's a lot more startup businesses that are being backed by private capital that are trying to work in spaces like this. And, you know, I'm thinking of probably the most headlines have gone to Hermes, for example. They've started getting DoD contracts to develop, a Mach 5 transport aircraft, for example. There are certainly companies and there's private capital who are interested in trying to move this technology into an area that's not just missiles. And, you know, whether that becomes viable, as with any startup, right, maybe it's going to succeed, maybe it doesn't. But certainly, whether this sort of first batch of startups succeeds or not, the technology that they demonstrate will go on to live another life somewhere down the road. In a future startup or make its way into some of the bigger airframers and things like that. So I certainly think that there is a push going on right now that's going to try to get us into an area where people might be transported this quickly. How fast that happens, whether or not it comes to fruition, I couldn't tell you. I think that there's, from a technical standpoint, it's doable. From a regulatory, and cost standpoint, I don't know the answer to that.
Thank you. Erica, you have a national perspective on this. Where do you see hypersonics evolving to over the next decade?
Well, going with like human transport is the theme for this. You don't have to fly hypersonics to take advantage of the technology that's being developed for hypersonics. So cost-wise, jet fuel-wise, it may make sense to fly at Mach 4, a passenger jet. And I think you've seen some companies already make purchases for supersonic aircraft that are going to be leveraging hypersonic technologies in a subsonic type of flow environment. But specific to what we're talking about is it's a system of systems. And everything from how do the microelectronics operate at temperature will impact any of your handheld electronic devices in the future. Any of the materials that withstand the internal combustion environment can be used in other type of engine systems. So I'll just stop there because I can keep going. But I'm curious to see if John has some other comments to that, because that's what you guys do.
Yeah, you guys really hit a couple of big things. Maybe taking it down to a more elemental level, something that both Alex and Jesse are really talking about is when you get into hypersonic flows, you have a very highly.
Did he just freeze up on us? He'll come back to us in a second, hopefully. Mr. Little, do you want to jump in here?
Sure. I mean, we've heard, as Alex mentioned and Erica as well, we've heard a few comments from other industries about building hypersonic vehicles for passenger transport. But I think Erica's comments is probably the most apropos here is that a lot of the things that we're building will trickle down to things that don't necessarily fly hypersonic for commercial vehicles. It looks like John's back, so I'll kick it back to him.
Yes, sorry about that. I was wondering why nobody was moving. I think what Alex and Jesse are talking about, a lot of what they're saying is, you know, hypersonic design is so challenging because it's a highly coupled problem. And by that, I mean how the aero impacts the thermal and how the thermal impacts the structural. You can't decouple those things. You know, Jesse talks about, you know, boundary layer interaction. So shock boundary layer interaction, how you get very significant changes thermally over very short distances in time or distances, you know, really impacts your how your vehicle responds and what it does and creates, you know, big design challenges. I think when you start looking at those types of solutions that are being generated and the digital capability that gets developed by having to work through those kinds of challenging problems, I think that stuff is going to translate into a lot of other areas where you have similar challenges. So a lot of the basic research and stuff like that, I think, will help push a lot of other challenges forward where we've got a lot of coupled thermal challenges and materials problems to deal with.
Okay, and now this question may veer into the classified, may not. There's a lot of literature out there already, but when you're talking Mach 5 level, you know, you're really talking about a potential where the cruise missile doesn't even need a warhead, or, you know, a device, a warhead at the front end. Is that accurate, or is what's the perspective on that?
Yeah, I don't really want to talk into too many design details of the systems and things like that. I mean, I think, you know, the capabilities we're developing and stuff like that are probably things we really can't go into here, even though I understand the curiosity.
Yep. And maybe that's more appropriate for university researchers to take a shot at. Your thoughts on that question?
Yeah, I don't know what specifically any of us are allowed to say other than, you know, kinetic energy scales with square velocity, right? So going faster can give you lots of different things to play with in terms of design. I don't know about specific designs that are in the works or systems. And, you know, even if I did, as John has said, I wouldn't be able to talk about that, but it certainly you've got a lot more kinetic energy when you're moving faster.
And my understanding is, you know, there's efforts beyond Mach 5, for example, which are interesting. Anybody else care to chime in on that question? I do have a question from a participant that's asking if most of the work near term will continue to stay in the classified domain, or can some of the unclassified portions be contracted out to local aerospace and defense companies?
Well, I would point out that almost everything that the university is doing is unclassified, but increasingly the Department of Defense is putting other types of controls on you know, this kind of information. So certainly, there are lots of small businesses that are working in this space that we work with, that I think Raytheon and others work with. But there definitely still is going to be the requirement for a lot of that work that the information has certain controls attached to it. Even if it doesn't rise to the level of classified, that doesn't mean that it's not controlled in some way. I don't know how else to really dig into that.
Now you're hitting on a good topic, Alex. You know, I think we certainly work with a lot of small businesses, you know, across the nation, really. You know, not just in Tucson, and we do work with a lot of businesses within Tucson. So not everything requires, you know, a classified environment to build it in, and we certainly have a pretty significant supply chain where we utilize a lot of companies both locally and you know, across the nation that provide unique capabilities.
Okay. Audience members,
I guess I will say that I think this goes back to, this made me think of something. This does sort of go back to the workforce challenge again, though, because you look at, we have students come through here, obviously, all the time, and they, you ask them what they want to do, what they're inspired by, and a lot of them are saying, hey, we, you know, look at all this cool stuff SpaceX is doing. You know, I want to build, you know, rockets that fly to the moon, and that's all, that, I mean, it's a cool problem, right? This is not to, you know, denigrate the idea of building orbital vehicles, right? But a lot of what they're doing is a lot more visible than this field. And so in moving the needle on workforce and getting, you know, students and high schoolers interested in these kind of fields as they're entering into college, it makes the challenge that much harder when there's less that you can show. Because, I mean, frankly, there's a lot of cool stuff going on in this area. But as this, you know, question in the chat came up, a lot of it just can't be shown publicly. And I think that has made our challenge of finding and motivating, you know, kids and early career students to get into a field like this that much more challenging.
Which leads me to the thinking, are there, okay, so it's clear that generating interest for students pursuing U.S. citizens in particular pursuing this field is very, very important to the future of hypersonics. And perhaps that's part of the challenge I'll issue in just a second here. Are there other questions that audience members want to chime in on? Feel free to include those in the chat now. We're getting close to the top of the hour here, but what I think would be appropriate is to discuss, well, what else? What can be done based on this enriching discussion on the future of hypersonics? But to me, I think we can help come in and give it more visibility, Alex, to be able to attract that workforce, that student interest that you're talking about. In a sense, one can argue that the future of hypersonics is akin to, you know, the 21st century Manhattan project, right? It's that important. And is it receiving the due attention that it deserves? You know, I pose that as a question for all of us to think about. And I can't think of a better organization than the Arizona Technology Council to help lead in these efforts. Certainly a committee to form around this area. And then the myriad number of ways that the council convenes people can help focus an effort within the STEM education on hypersonics as an example. With that, let's move to, I don't see any other questions coming in, but the audience members, go ahead and chime in. Let us know what you thought about the panel and the topic. I will go to closing comments, starting with Jesse Little.
Sure. Thanks again for putting this event together. It was great to be able to share some of what we're doing with a larger group of people, especially within the state. And I already mentioned this before, but we're really focused on this here at the university, and we have great partners with Raytheon and others, especially in the regional sense. And I do expect that more great things will be coming out of these efforts.
Very well. Thank you so much, sir. Alex Craig.
Yeah, I guess one thing I'll note before leaving is that, I mean, frankly, we've been flying objects at hypersonic speeds in an aerodynamic sense since the 1950s. So the idea of something moving at hypersonic speeds is not new. What's new is that we're trying to do it in a way where we can maneuver and that makes things inherently more challenging. And that goes back to what John said about this being sort of a coupled system of different problems. And one of the things that I think at the university that we've really been working on and that this university consortium in a more nationwide sense is working on is getting people like me and Jesse and Erica to sort of de-silo ourselves a little bit so that, I've got my pet problems to work on, but I need to have an appreciation for what Erica does and what the guidance and navigation people do. And in the process, we're trying to get our students to have that broader perspective so that when they go out and work for people like John, they have a better appreciation for how all of these pieces fit together, and we can develop these things faster.
Alex, thank you so much, Erica and John Otto. Rapid fire closure here. I'm coming to closure, Erica.
Just to bring awareness to the leadership that U of A, Raytheon, and our industrial base has currently in Raytheon, and how do we maintain that leadership by future investments by the state?
Thank you so much, Erica. John Otto.
Yeah, I think it's an exciting time to be working in this field. I haven't seen this level of working across university industry at any point in my career up until now. So I think this is really exciting, and we're looking forward to what we can do and bring to this area.
Okay, so thank you to Raytheon and the University of Arizona, this exceptional panel. Perhaps a call to action to consider would be to convene a subject matter interest area within the auspices of the Arizona Technology Council. A hypersonics committee, Carla, back to you.
Thank you, Alex. Actually, I appreciate that the opportunity. It's definitely something that we can look into. I'd like to take the time to thank Erica, John, Alex Craig, and Jesse, and of course, our moderator, Alex Rodriguez. Thank you all so much for sharing your subject matter expertise and your time with us. I have to tell you, we have many, many Tech Talk series. We are 3 minutes after the hour, and there are still people logged on interested in continuing this conversation. So there's obviously a great interest. I appreciate the different perspectives and the well-roundedness of the conversation. For our attendees, please keep in mind that the chat includes many resources that our CEO, Steve Seltzer, shared in the chat feature. Please make sure you log in and take advantage of those resources, as well as visit our YouTube channel where this recording can be found. If you want to go back and listen to some of the material, we encourage you to please visit us on the YouTube channel and familiarize not only with this topic, but many others. excuse me. I'd also like to thank the University Advancing Technology for being the presenting sponsor of our virtual Tech Speaker Series events. We look forward to seeing you tomorrow at Leonardo Electronics or at one of our upcoming events. Thank you all so much. Have a wonderful rest of the week. That was super fast. Thank you all. Have a great day.
Thank you.
Thank you, everybody.